This week on WealthTrack, small cap value manager David Nadel raced to first place among all foreign mutual funds last year with the Royce International Premier Fund, and also led the field in the European fund category with his Royce European Small Cap Fund. This champion strategy is next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholm Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. In these uncertain times, investors are looking for safety and stability. For the stock portions of our portfolios, that usually means large cap U.S. stocks, which are valued for their quality, strength, and liquidity. Well, that thesis is certainly being tested this year, and it did not do very well last year either. Most major market indices lost money. The few that didn't were propped up by a handful of tech stocks known as the FANGs: Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google. Given the headlines coming out of international markets, investors have been wary of them. Yet some of the best places to invest have been overseas. The Euro Stoxx Index advanced 8%, and despite its dramatic roller coaster course, the Shanghai Composite finished the year up better than 9%. One of the last places investors would think of during challenging markets is the small cap universe, especially international small caps. Yet the Global X U.S. Small Cap Index eked out a small gain last year, besting its U.S. brethren, and one of the best performing foreign markets was the European Small Cap Index, which advanced more than 9%. Well, this week's guest led the charge with two top performing funds. He is David Nadel, Director of International Research for the Royce Funds, which was founded and is still led by small cap pioneer Chuck Royce. Nadel is portfolio manager for several funds, including two ranked number one in their categories. The Royce International Premier Fund beat out all foreign fund competitors with its 16% plus gain last year, and the Royce European Small Cap Fund's 13% return led its Morningstar category. I asked Nadel for his view of the turmoil affecting all stocks globally.
To me, it seems a bit more like a credit-driven situation than necessarily something that is driven by fundamentals of a lot of the companies in the stock market. You see what's happened to Deutsche Bank, what's happened to Bank of America. The banks have gotten, bank stocks have gotten hit very hard. And there certainly are, I think, legitimate credit concerns out there. But it strikes me as more financial than fundamental. And people will often look at stock market activity and then extrapolate, oh, gee, the economy must be doing poorly, or there must be a slowdown in growth. And I think some of that is coincident not causal. It's guessing connections. But the credit part of the equation and all of this connection between the oil price and the volatility, again, these are really, to me, more of a financial or credit-related nature than they are fundamental. But the companies that we speak to, you know, on a daily basis, industrial companies, healthcare companies, consumer companies,
right. But
for the most part, or with some exceptions, but for the most part, are not seeing major changes in demand in their affecting their top line.
So they're not worried about a global recession?
For the most part, yes.
Right.
I mean, companies that have specific exposure in our portfolio, for example, to Russia or to China, or to the aerospace sector, there have been pockets where there is definitely concern about demand slowdown.
Right.
Same thing with we are invested in a company that does shipbroking. You know, this is an obvious area related to global trade and oil again,
mm-hmm.
where there is an effect on demand. But if you look at the broader picture of the economy versus that sort of narrow scope of banks and credit related issues, it strikes me that there's a bit of a disconnect there.
Let's talk about small caps, which is your specialty, international small caps in particular. But the impression out there is that small cap stocks are much more volatile and vulnerable in market downturns like we're experiencing. Is that the case? Is that just one of the characteristics of the small cap universe in general?
Yeah, I mean, again, I think I would draw a distinction between the operating performance of those businesses and the share price activity of those businesses. So sort of the difference between price and value, if you will. If you're exposed to sectors that have high portions of recurring revenue, businesses that have very strong balance sheets, high returns on invested capital, they tend to be able to self-fund. They don't find themselves in a desperate situation of needing financing at a tough moment. They tend to be the companies that take market share when times are tough. They actually like tough times, kind of like a value investor. So that type of profile, I think, is rewarded over time in the stock market. But as smaller companies do tend to get tossed around a bit more, smaller market caps just get tossed around a bit more in the stock market. We have some companies where, you know, the charts kind of look like this. They just keep going up. We have others that have gotten thrown around a little bit. But we're much more interested in the actual operating results of these businesses and their ability to sustain or possibly improve the moat surrounding their business than we are necessarily in short-term price action. The short-term price action really creates a huge amount of opportunity for us, because without that volatility, there is no arbitrage in terms of buying businesses at discounted prices when they're temporarily dislocated.
So are you actually finding more opportunities now because of what's going on in the market?
Absolutely. There's no question.
I looked at last year's results, and you know, you are running two top performing mutual funds of 2015, which I mentioned in the introduction to you.
Yep.
And you know, it's interesting that they're small cap international funds, but in fact it was kind of a textbook case of diversification working in this case, where international small caps actually did well and your funds did extremely well. You're saying that this is not a one-off, that in fact that the international small cap class has some key attributes that are very attractive. What are they?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think typically investors, when they look beyond the what is typically a narrow scope of their portfolios being very U.S. focused, and they think about, well, should I invest abroad? The first place they usually go is to large caps.
And the multinationals.
Right. The challenge with that strategy is you're repeating a lot of what you're doing at home, because a foreign-based multinational isn't really that different from a U.S.-based multinational. And so the domicile doesn't make that much of a difference. In the small cap space, you have a broader range of businesses to choose from. You have a lot of companies that are global number ones or global number twos in a niche, high market shares in niche areas. But you have a range of companies to choose from, anywhere from very globally structured businesses to very country-specific businesses. Again, hard to replicate that in a large cap strategy, a country-specific company. So if we think about in the Royce International Premier Fund, a holding like VZ Holding is a Swiss-only business. Bajaj Finance is an India-only business. Adanta Prev is a Brazil-only business. If you want, if you like the characteristics of those countries and those businesses, again, hard to replicate with a large cap strategy. Overall, the performance of international small caps on a rolling monthly 10-year basis, performance has been better than U.S. small caps, but with less volatility.
So that's interesting.
So that is surprising often for people to hear, that the international subset is less volatile than the U.S. subset when it comes to small caps. Correlations between international small cap and U.S. stocks overall are less than 0.6 in terms of performance correlation. That's a very low number. Obviously, 1.0 would be perfect correlation.
Right.
So lower correlation in international small caps.
So you're diversifying your equity portion of your portfolio.
Precisely.
Less volatility.
Exactly.
Right. And the other thing is that I think you told me at one point there were 25,000.
That's right. There are 25,000 companies traded outside the U.S. with market caps of $5 billion or less.
Right.
It's about four times the number of small cap companies as you have in the U.S. So there's no question that it increases in a huge way your opportunity set.
Right.
And then it's a question of finding a strategy where you're picking companies that you actually do want to own and invest in for the long term, because arguably a large portion of that universe is not really so investable. Loss-making
right.
companies, not such great companies, low liquidity, et cetera.
Tell me about the dividend-paying capabilities in the international small caps.
It's very common to find dividends with international small cap stocks. I think every holding in the Royce International Premier Fund pays a dividend. Some of them are small yields, some of them are generous yields. That's not because we've sought out dividends. It's just because it's very common that that's the case. The companies are often in an earlier stage of their corporate evolution. There's often a family that's involved. They want that dividend for an income stream. And the whole culture of kind of trading in your own shares is not well regarded outside of the US. It's kind of frowned upon.
Mm-hmm.
So again, the dividend becomes more important rather than a CEO buying here, selling there. They're not going to trade their shares as much. They're going to rely on that dividend. The dividend yields being twice what they are in the U.S., that's consistent with the valuation picture overall. You know, if you look at the cyclically adjusted price-earnings ratio, the last 10 years of earnings, this Robert Shiller PE
right.
we were talking about before.
The CAPE ratio.
So international stocks are trading at about 16 times the average of the last 10 years of earnings. U.S. stocks are at about 24 times the average of the last 10 years of earnings. So that's a pretty large gap.
That is.
So, I think international stocks are really set up for a period of potential margin expansion because margins are depressed, unlike U.S. equities where they're at, post-World War II high profit margin levels. So margins are depressed for international stocks, and the multiples are much lower. So you have this potential for margin expansion, multiple expansion. And when things move in the right direction, it can be dramatic.
As a value investor, what do you look for when you're looking for an international small cap? And in the Royce International Premier, you're talking about 50 holdings, so it's very focused.
That's right. It's quite focused. We look, I think, first of all, for businesses that have a clear customer benefit. That is extremely important to us.
Meaning,
analyzing the business from the perspective of the customer mm-hmm. rather than the perspective of a shareholder. If the customer is happy, shareholder returns are going to be fine over time, typically. We look for also more standard financial characteristics that investors would typically focus on, high returns on invested capital that we feel can be sustained or improved, a very strong balance sheet, so typically at least half the balance sheet being comprised of shareholder's equity, which is a pretty punishing requirement.
Mm-hmm.
So businesses that can self-fund. We look for businesses that have a moat-like structure. They're high barriers to entry, often a high portion of recurring revenue. We like this kind of, they're businesses that have the capacity to compound shareholder returns over time. But they're often, on the surface of it, they're often quite boring or kind of dull businesses.
For instance, what would be a typical Royce International Premier?
So Spirk Sarco is the global number one in steam systems. And the first thing people think of when they think of steam systems, they think of the steam engine, which is, has nothing to do with this business model. The steam applications are used for things like pharmaceutical production, food processing. It's an industry that grows at about twice the rate of GDP. So it's actually a growth market. There are systems, traps, all kinds of stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
But the fascinating thing with Spirk Sarco, and this is where the dull and boring part comes in, is only about a quarter of their sales are comprised of upfront systems, steam systems, if you will. And there, by the way, this company is 10 times the size of the number two in the marketplace. So they have really consolidated.
Dominant. And where are they based?
They're based in the UK.
In the UK.
Yeah. But 3/4 of their revenue comes from the back end. It comes from what you could call spares and repairs. So, all of the maintenance, and again, this stuff coming from the maintenance CapEx budgets of their customers, a very reliable source of revenue. You have to go to a Spirk Sarco service person to service your product. He comes and visits you. He upsells you on some product. They've compounded revenue at about 8% a year for 25 years. 44 straight years of dividend increases. The sort of business model that really allows you to sleep at night.
How shareholder friendly, how you know, how shareholder-centric do you want them to be? Is that a key consideration as well, or
Well, we certainly don't want them to be shareholder-unfriendly.
Right.
You know, shareholder-friendliness, I think there's a few forms of shareholder-friendliness. Mm-hmm. There's good disclosure. There's the most important thing to us is that the business is being managed for returns more than growth per se. That they know to grow within their franchise, not to diversify and quote unquote diversify. When businesses often buy inferior companies just to either diversify for themselves or to try to stimulate growth when things are slowing.
Right.
We would prefer to do the diversification ourselves as portfolio managers. That's why you have 50 stocks in the portfolio. So those are the sort of things that we look for.
And where are you finding the most value now when you look around the world for the international small cap stocks?
Well, the target rich environments for us are developed market areas more so than emerging markets.
And the reason for that is?
Well, generally the tradition of corporate governance, of the quality of the businesses, the orientation towards managing a business for returns on capital as opposed to growth, that tends to be, those are sort of characteristics that you find disproportionately in developed markets, in mature markets. I would say Europe, particularly north of the Alps, the UK, Germany, Switzerland, those are target-rich environments. Not necessarily where the best opportunity is now in terms of value. The one I would single out for value now is Japan. I mean, just as we've seen what's happened in the beginning of 2016, now that 2015 is behind us.
And of course, Japan, I don't think of Japan as being a small business friendly environment. Are there lots of small businesses in Japan?
Lots of great small businesses. And increasingly export adept businesses, companies that have become a play on pan-Asian growth. This market, Japan, was half of global market cap less than 25 years ago.
I know, and now
it's 8% of global market cap now. And a lot of that money has just kind of flowed to the faster growing parts of Asia, if you will. But when you invest directly in the faster parts of Asia, you don't always get the corporate governance that you get in Japan, which some people will be critical of Japanese corporate governance, but it's better than the alternative, and it's getting a lot better. Return on equity orientation, less promoting by hierarchy, more female participation in the workforce. Japan is changing. I think some of those changes are kind of inexorable, but in 2016, it's the market has really gotten shellacked. So we've seen a lot of value there. I think of our Japanese holdings, they're generally trading at 12 to 15% pre-tax earnings yield. So somewhere around, 6 to 8 times pre-tax earnings, not big multiples. And often at, 4 or 5 times net cash, because these companies have very strong balance sheets. Again, Japan has this reputation for being indebted. That's sovereign debt.
Yes.
It's not corporate debt.
Because there are a couple of other things when you're talking about investing in these other countries is that a lot of international funds hedge their local currencies versus the dollar.
Yeah.
You don't hedge.
Correct.
Which can work in your favor and work very much against you. So why don't you hedge and how has that affected your performance in the Royce International Premier Fund, for instance?
Yeah, so the effect on performance has been fairly dramatic, actually, by choosing not to hedge. Cumulatively, since the inception of the fund through 5 years ago through December 31st, I think cumulatively with all the dividend distributions, the funds returned about 45-48%, somewhere in that range. That's in U.S. dollars, as reported. That's the return that investors actually get. But in local currency, that return was in the mid-70s.
Ooh.
So it's not a surprising difference, because during that 5-year stretch of time, the dollar is appreciated about 30% versus a basket of currencies, and pretty much a nonstop appreciation of the currency. So it is, I sometimes feel like managing a portfolio with one hand tied behind my back. But on the other hand, at this juncture, if you're looking to diversify to an international portfolio, do you really want a hedged portfolio, or do you want an unhedged portfolio? I would argue that currencies are kind of a mean reverting phenomenon.
Right. So you think the dollar, maybe the big surge in the dollar, is
either going to slow,
and
we've seen a little bit of that at the beginning of this year. Mm-hmm. That there's actually been a little bit of dollar weakness. I mean, in the scale of the last 5 years, it's a blip.
Right.
But You know, that is something that an investor should think about, because there are peers to us. Most peers do hedge currency. Most of them are doing it partially, not fully. There are some products out there that are fully hedged. So consumers, investors have this choice of everything from completely non-hedged to completely hedged. But they should be aware, when comparing products to peer performance, that funds that have hedged partially obviously are advantaged in terms of their performance than in the last 5 years.
And also, you don't like ADRs. Why?
Well, it's not that I dislike ADRs. It's that I think an ADR-focused strategy is very limited. ADRs tend to be issued disproportionately by emerging markets. Countries like Mexico, Brazil, China is a big issuer of ADRs, typically directed at a U.S. audience. And also disproportionately large cap, and often what would be called SOEs, state-owned enterprises. State-owned enterprises generally don't have great corporate governance, not the best anyway. When you invest in locally traded shares, you're opening yourself up to a much broader market, really a higher quality market, more of a small cap market. And you think about a market, we were talking about Japan earlier. Japan has virtually no ADRs because they have a wealthy home market that can be the investor in their own equities. So we're kind of visiting from the outside, but we can do that with any country and not be limited to the countries where ADRs are popular.
David, give me a couple of other examples of companies. We talked about Spirax, Sarco.
Another thing that we look for in businesses is a favorable market structure. One of probably the top contributing holding of the Royce International Premier Fund since inception in terms of performance is an Indian company called Bajaj Finance. Mm-hmm. And Bajaj Finance is a consumer lender. India has one of the least penetrated lending markets in the world. In fact, something like a fifth of Indians have no loan whatsoever.
No credit, no bank account, no whatever.
Exactly, just totally unbanked.
Right.
And yet the default rates in India and sort of non-performing loan rates are actually quite good. Household debt as a portion of GDP, it's about 10%. Here it's close to 100% of GDP. So really an under-penetrated market. This is a very well-managed company, part of the Bajaj family of companies. And they have been able to grow their asset base earnings at sort of 25% a year, based on the structure of the market being very favorable, natural barriers to entry, regulatory barriers to entry. And so that's another class of company that we find appealing.
If you had to pick one investment for a long-term portfolio, long-term diversified portfolio, what would it be?
Yeah, always difficult to pick one investment. I think I would probably go with one of our top holdings, VZ Holding. I mentioned it earlier. It's a Swiss wealth manager. VZ has a very clear customer benefit, which is, again, that place where we start.
Yes.
It's a one-stop shop for all the financial services that anyone could have, from investing to insurance to tax to succession planning. I mean, they target 50-year-old plus homeowners. And in Switzerland, about half of that demographic have gross assets of 2 to 5 million Swiss francs. It's not a poor country.
No, it is not.
And they have something like 25,000 clients. That's only about 10% penetration of their addressable market. They're moving into a 15th year since founding of unbroken profitable growth. They expanded operating margins and revenue through the global economic crisis. Very low risk model, one which has just a lot of recurring revenue. They keep layering on clients. And an example, by the way, of another country specific business. Again, tough to replicate.
In Switzerland,
yeah. And there's a kind of network effect to this, right? I mean, the more people that sign up for this, something like a third of their new clients come from referral.
Mm-hmm.
So I like and generous dividend yields. It's a nice business.
All right. David Nadel, thank you so much for joining us.
Consuelo, thank you very much for having me back. Always a pleasure.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's Action Point takes a page from Peter Lynch, the legendary former portfolio manager of Fidelity's Magellan Fund. It is know what you own and know why you own it. You might have already gone through the painful exercise of reviewing your portfolio's performance for last year. It's only going to look worse now, but a quick stress test analysis might actually make you feel better. Whatever you own is cheaper than it was just a few weeks ago. Do you want to make some slight adjustments? Add to long-term holdings and sell investments you have been meaning to exit. Once you have completed the exercise, the best course of action might be to follow the advice of another investment legend, Bernard Baruch. When asked what was the thing he did that made him the most money as an investor, he allegedly said, "Sitting on my hands." Well, next week, we're going to talk to an investor who frequently does just that. Great value investor Wally Weitz will join us for a rare television interview. To see this program again and other WealthTrack interviews, go to our website, WealthTrack.com, where you can also listen to our exclusive extra interview with David Nadel about what keeps him calm during periods of market stress. Also, feel free to reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.